There is a book,
thank you,
written by Karnamrita Das called Babaji Maharaj, and it's in two parts, Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, and the other one is Srila Jagannath Das Babaji. So I'm going to read some excerpts from the what he wrote about Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj. So the first one is called Family Life and Renunciation. Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj appeared sometime in the 1830s in the district of Faridpur, adjacent to the place called Tepakola in the village of Vagyana in East Bengal, or what is now known as Bangladesh. He appeared in that village, which is situated on the bank of the Padma River, as the son of a Vaishya, most probably called Vanshidas. According to one biographer, however, Vanshidas was the name of Srila Gaurakishore Das before he took the renounced order. During his boyhood, his mother and father arranged a marriage for him, and he remained in household affairs for more than 20 years. While a householder, he worked as a broker in the grain business, but even at that time, he exhibited his spirituality. After the demise of his wife, Srila Gaurakishore left his business and went to Vrindavan. There he approached Srila Bhagavat Das Babaji, one of the foremost disciples of Srila Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj, and accepted from him the traditional Paramahansa Vaishnava Babaji dress. After this, he became completely renounced and sojourned under trees in various parts of the 168-mile Vrajamandal circle of Vrindavan. He continuously acted thus for a period of approximately 30 years. During this time, he would sometimes travel to the holy places of pilgrimage in northern and western India, as well as the Gauramandala circle of Navadvip. He associated with Srila Sarup Das Babaji Maharaj in Jagannath Puri, whose ecstatic activities were recounted by Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur in his autobiography. He also associated with Sri Bhagavan Das Babaji in Kulna. He went to Kulia, the holy site of Srila Jagannath Das Babaji's bhajan, and associated with Srila Chaitanya Das Babaji. All of these Babajis were pure and exalted devotees. Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji became very famous among the great devotees of Vrindavan and was awarded the appropriate title of Bhajanandi. Even though he received such honor, he never endeavored for even a modicum of material sense gratification and totally disapproved of the secret material desires of pseudo renunciants. He was entirely removed from such inclinations and would perform his pure, unalloyed devotional pastimes alone in a profound devotional mood. In the year 1897, during the month of Falgun, when he was in his 60s, and at that time when the Yoga Peet, birth site of Sri Chaitanya, was revealed by the exertions of Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur, Srila Gaurakishore Prabhu proceeded to Navadvip Dham from Vrindavan under the instruction of Srila Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj. From this time until his disappearance, Srila Gaurakishore Das remained in Sri Navadvip Dham, living in different villages and realizing their non-difference from the holy places of Vrindavan. He begged by gathering dry foodstuffs from the householders of the holy Dham. he would sometimes offer those foodstuffs to the Supreme Personality of Godhead by the simple expedient of holding them in his hand. In order to cook, he would collect dry wood from the paths, and he would wash earthen pots discarded by the villagers along the roadside near the Ganges on the occasion of eclipses. Due to the effects of an eclipse, such pots were considered impure and unusable. In order to clothe himself, he would go to the shore of the Ganges and collect and wash discarded cloth that had been used to cover corpses at the burning ghat. Thus, he always remained independent of the support of others, simply by utilizing items of no value to anyone else. In such a manner, he obtained the practical necessities of life. In 1897, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur constructed his place of bhajan on the bank of the Sarasvati River at Godruma, the island of the nine islands of Navadvip Dham, which represents kirtan, recitation of the names and glories of God. That ashram, which was called Swananda Sukhada Kunj and consisted of a moderate two-story house, several small outbuildings, and a walled compound, was a gathering place for exalted souls. Previously, it had been the site of Lord Nityananda's Namhut, the place from which Lord Nityananda inaugurated his preaching exploits in Bengal under the order of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Here, the Thakur recited and explained the Srimad Bhagavatam and other topics regarding the conclusions of devotional service. And Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj would come and hear those talks with great delight. The Thakur often cited the behavior of Srila Gaurakishore to elucidate the meaning of the word nirapeksha, indifference. He often discussed the unequaled renunciation, pure devotion, and attachment to Krishna that Babaji Maharaj displayed. In the days of the Thakur's retirement, the two souls met and associated in great happiness. For some time, Babaji Maharaj stayed in Surabhi Kunj and performed Hari Bhajan. His room, which adjoined the wall of the Kunj, has been preserved. Babaji Maharaj displayed fervent enthusiasm upon hearing the discourses of the Thakur. His only possessions were the tulsi beads he wore around his neck and the tulsi mala he kept in his hand for counting his rounds. He also kept a few books, such as Narottam Das Thakur's Prarthana and Prema Bhakti Chandrika. Sometimes he wore a torn cloth, and sometimes he went naked. At other times, he would utter harsh sounds of disgust for no apparent reason. Even though it appeared that Gaurakishore Das Babaji was not a learned Sanskrit scholar, still the purport and conclusions of all scriptures were luminous in his heart and character. It was never possible for anyone to serve him, for he was never willing to accept any kind of service from any person. Whosoever witnessed his unearthly, genuine condition of renunciation was reminded of the pastimes of Srila Raghunath Das Goswami. All kinds of divine powers and opulences were always waiting as his command, ready to serve him. Sometimes such powers would be manifest in the form of his appearing to be omniscient. He was always able to reveal the deceitful nature lying within the hearts of pretenders. Although a person resided outside his immediate purview, Srila Gaurakishore could elaborately and scrutinizingly reveal the person's cheating nature because he was in direct contact with Supersoul. This ability, however, was not his principal virtue. He exhibited the highest standard of devotion to the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna, and because of his exemplary character, he was recognized as the personification of the deepest degree of separation from Lord Sri Krishna. This is what distinguished him from most other Vaishnavas and what spread the luster of his lotus feet. Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur has thus written, "Many young, clever, old, learned, foolish, proud, and reasonable persons came into contact with Srila Gaurakishore Prabhu, yet they could not realize his real identity. This is indeed the mystic opulence of the devotees of Lord Krishna. Many persons came to consult with Srila Gaurakishore Prabhu about their insignificant desires. They would always get suggestions, but those suggestions were usually the cause of their disappointment. Innumerable persons accepted the Babaji dress and acted as devotees of the Lord, but actually they were imposters, far away from being real sadhus. Srila Gaurakishore never accepted such a false way of life. His sincerity was apparent in itself. His loving attitude was such that even when he obtained a very opulent offering, his renunciation predominated. Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji never displayed any distaste for those persons who were inimical to him. He also never manifested any special affection for those very dear to him. He would often express himself by saying, "In this material world, I am all alone in my service to Lord Krishna. Everyone is worshipable by me." Another noteworthy transcendental topic is that many materialistic foolish persons masquerading as devotees and imitating pure devotion would come and surround him. They would consider that they were the dear objects of his affection while they engaged their minds in so many worldly sense objects. Srila Gaurakishore Prabhu would never display any intention of driving them away and also no symptoms of a compromising attitude. So this next excerpt is entitled Deception and Devotional Service. Once, a resident of Bangladesh, who was a very wealthy landlord, scholar, and brahmana, and reputed to be a great devotee of the Lord, came with a friend to see Srila Babaji Maharaj. The landowner appeared to be so deeply absorbed in devotional ecstasy that his friend had to support him as he walked, lest he fall down due to excessive trembling of the body. When the pair arrived before Babaji Maharaj, two other persons in the assembly, recognizing the famous landlord, immediately received him as an advanced devotee of the Lord. They carefully offered their obeisances to him and arranged a sitting place. At that time, Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji, in his pastime of blindness, inquired, "Who has come?" The friend of the landlord introduced his companion by glowingly describing his erudition and devotion and his being disinterested in material sense gratification, despite possessing unlimited wealth. He then described how only a fortnight earlier, a thief had come and stolen 45,000 rupees from the landlord's house. But despite suffering such a setback, The landowner, knowing devotion to be much more significant, had come to obtain Srila Babaji Maharaj's transcendental darshan. The friend added, "I am his friend. He has left all material sense gratification and keeps only my association. You will be able to realize his greatness by conversing with him. He once asked me a question about a confidential exchange between Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Srila Ramananda Roy found in Chaitanya Charitamrita. I told him that only Gaurakishore Das Babaji could properly answer his questions, and certainly no one else. We have already been to see many learned persons in this area, and yet we cannot come to an agreement about the meaning of this conversation. So we think that only you are able to explain it properly." After the introduction was complete, Srila Babaji Maharaj replied, "I will tell you a process by which you can understand the conclusion of this conversation. But before trying to understand these confidential topics between Lord Chaitanya and Ramananda Roy, you should renounce the association of this rascal imposter landholder, and you should take shelter of a pure devotee of the Lord. You should hear the Chaitanya Charitamrita 100 times in the association of authentic devotees of the Lord. In this way, being absorbed in devotional ecstasy, you will be able to realize the purport of these conversations. At the present moment, all the devotees here want to perform congregational chanting of the holy name of the Lord. We don't have time to discuss any other topics." Having thus spoken, Srila Babaji Maharaj very loudly requested that everyone perform Harinam Sankirtan. Everyone then began to congregationally chant the Lord's holy name. After hearing the statement of Babaji Maharaj, the proud landlord and his friend immediately left that place. Later that evening, when almost everyone had left, some of the members of the assembly commented to Babaji Maharaj, "That very learned landowner was absorbed in devotional ecstasy. We could not see any manifestation of material consciousness in him. He was devoid of worldly consciousness." Another person sitting nearby, who had always heard that Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji was very straightforward with everyone, then inquired, "That person was so immersed in various loving devotional ecstasies that he could not even talk by his own efforts. How is it that you can say he was not on the highest platform of bhakti?" Srila Babaji Maharaj replied, "After speaking with him for a few moments, I could understand that he had no good intentions in his performance of devotional service. One cannot measure a person's devotion by the approval of the general mass of people. If a person is not serious in his devotional service, then even if he exhibits the symptoms of renunciation, non-attachment, and various ecstasies, still he should not be considered to have real renunciation or detachment. As soon as a difficult test comes, his false renunciation will cease. Detachment seeks out those who are actually fixed in their intention to perform devotional service. When performing practical devotional service, we should never exhibit our devotional ecstasies. One should perform devotional service in such a way that one's deep attachment to the Lord increases within his heart. Even if one displays hundreds and hundreds of exhibitions of external attachment. He will not be blessed by the Lord if he does not develop an internal loving attachment to Krishna. If one genuinely possesses a deep loving attitude, then Krishna himself will approach and claim such an advanced devotee. Whoever is not enticed by the fragrance of unflinching devotional service and whose heart is filled with material desires will wear different types of external bodily dress. Krishna is proportionately aloof or available according to the degree of one's surrender. If one is deeply immersed in devotional attachment to Lord Hari, then even while suffering distressing diseases or other material miseries, he will still remain absorbed in transcendental loving service of the Lord. If you can fast and chant Hare Krishna both day and night, and when you can always cry out with desire for the service of Rishubhanu's Radharani without revealing it to others, then Sri Krishna, who is very dear to Srimati Radharani, will call you to take his shelter. Srila Prabhupada, strictly following the line of Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj instructions, never made any sort of public display of ecstasy. And when his ecstatic emotions occasionally overpowered him, he would endeavor mightily to bring them in rein. This mood can be compared to that of Daruka, Krishna's charioteer, who was once fanning the Lord with a chamara. While thus engaged, he became overwhelmed with ecstatic love for the Lord, and the symptoms became manifest in his body. Prabhupada comments, Daruka was so serious about his service that he checked all of these manifestations of ecstatic love and considered them hindrances to his engagement. He did not care very much for these manifestations, although they automatically developed. It is not that when one experiences spiritual ecstasy that he is required to put it on display for the edification of ordinary persons. In India, it is very common for sahajiyas who take spiritual life cheaply to make an elaborate public display of their so-called ecstasies. Such displays are pale reflections of true spiritual sentiments and are exhibited with material motives. This was clearly the case when the landlord who approached Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji in Vrindavan and Navadvip, it is not at all uncommon that such a person will enter a temple with an assistant or even a crowd of followers and go before the deity. Seeing the deity and hearing the kirtan, he begins to dance wildly and finally faints, and the assistant or group of followers then minister him with great sympathy and concern. Thereafter, a curious throng of pilgrims gathers and witnesses the pathetic scene. And when a sufficient crowd has gathered, the great soul revives and is assisted with great difficulty beyond the temple confines, where he hopes some of the unfortunate spectators will agree to become his followers and patrons. As Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji has demonstrated, the best procedure for dealing with such persons is to neglect them. Can I go to 8:30? It's okay? Okay. So this next one is called The Sharp Words of the Sadhu. Srila Gaurakishore Das Babaji always gave beneficial instructions to persons who approached him with faith and humility, no matter what their spiritual status. On one such occasion, a seeker went to Babaji Maharaj to hear topics concerning the Supreme Lord. But he heard some harsh words from him instead. The seeker therefore resolved to never go near Babaji Maharaj again. After some time, however, having been stricken with a distressed and troubled mind, he suddenly returned to see Babaji Maharaj. Babaji Maharaj, instantly realizing the reason for his depression, then told him, "Oh, you have left the association of devotees where topics about Krishna are discussed, and now you are living in a secluded place and performing solitary worship of Krishna. When one hears the topics of the Supreme Lord in the company of devotees, then one becomes freed from Maya's net of illusion. But if one performs worship of the Lord in a secluded place, not in association with devotees, one becomes caught by the illusory energy. As a consequence, instead of topics about the Supreme Lord possessing one's heart, mundane subject matters will occupy it instead." The seeker then replied, "I thought it better to reside in a secluded place and perform my own individual worship rather than to become disturbed by hearing the sharp words of a sadhu." But Babaji Maharaj replies, "Please take note that those sadhus who speak sharp words to drive away the witch of the illusory energy are actually the only real devotees of Krishna and friends of the living entities. The conditioned living being experiences the distressful quarreling of his wife and close relatives and is rudely treated by them until death. And yet he never desires to leave their association. On the other hand, he absorbs himself in trying to appease and serve them. But when a devotee of the Lord, who is always desirous of the living entity's ultimate welfare, chides him just once with instructions meant to drive away Maya, then the conditioned entity immediately makes plans to leave the saintly person for his entire life. If you actually want to perform devotional service properly, then you must accept the harsh language of the sadhu as the medicine by which Maya can be given up. By this, one can obtain the necessary spiritual advancement to successfully chant the holy name. The bound souls are prepared to accept unlimited abuse from their family members, but not a single sharp word from the sadhu who attempts to cut their attachment to illusory existence. The materialistic wife and family members induce a man to work like an ass and meanwhile deride him for not fulfilling all of their demands. And yet, while the family may legitimately plunder a man and denounce him bitterly for his shortcomings, the acquiescent victim is not in the least able to tolerate words which might awaken him to the reality of his situation. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur described the power of the sadhu in an essay called Search for Truth. Here is an excerpt. "There is no doubt that the words of the sadhu possess the power of destroying the evil propensities of one's mind. The sadhus in this way benefit everyone who associates with them. There are many things which we do not disclose to the sadhu. The real sadhu makes us speak out what we keep concealed in our hearts. He then applies the knife. The very word sadhu has no meaning other than this. He stands in front of the block with the uplifted sacrificial knife in his hand. The sensuous desires of men are like goats. The sadhu stands there to kill those desires by the merciful stroke of the keen edge of the sacrificial knife in the form of unpleasant language. If the sadhu turns into my flatterer, then he does me harm. He becomes my enemy. If he gives us flattery, then we are led to the road that brings enjoyment, but no real well-being. Without the association of devotees, one will almost certainly be overwhelmed by the illusory energy, and one's thoughts will naturally turn to gratifying one's senses. During the discussions between Lord Chaitanya and Ramananda Roy, Lord Chaitanya inquired, "Of all auspicious and beneficial activities, which is the best for the living entity?" Ramananda Roy replied, "The only auspicious activity is association with devotees of Krishna." And in Srimad Bhagavatam it is stated, "We are asking the most perfect welfare activity from you. I think that in this material world, association with devotees, even if be for a moment, is the greatest treasure house for mankind. The importance of materially conditioned devotees associating with saintly persons has thus been stressed by all Vaishnava authorities. Even those who seem to shun the company of others in order to prosecute their solitary worship. Although it is a fact that great Paramahansas like Srila Madhavendra Puri perform such solitary worship in complete purity, this cannot be imitated by neophytes." Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Anybody want to add anything? So that's Prabhu. Archita, anything to add? Yes. No, what should not be imitated is solitary worship. That was what's being imitated. I guess so. I know what you're getting at. I'm not a sadhu, so maybe a sadhu could answer this question. Archita, I think, is ready to answer.
Not in the mood of a sadhu, which I'm not, but we have very, very specific instructions on how to associate with devotees, so we follow that. How to associate with those who are on the same level, those who are on a lower level, those who are on a higher level. So we follow those instructions and then we avoid offense. If you think it's your duty to go around and correct everybody, you're definitely going to commit offense. When that duty is given to you, like Srila Bhaktisiddhanta said, that in the mood of service, I have to correct you as your spiritual master. But actually, I'm seeing all of you as my master. That was his mood. So if we have the correct mood and we're given the service of correcting others, then we do it. But otherwise, we should strictly try to avoid that mood of correcting others all the time.
Jyoti Karma, you wish to add anything? Anything you want to add?
I can't think of anything to add at the moment.
Anything else we'd like to discuss? The boss.
I think it'd be important to understand the lifestyle or the nature of that individual that is giving those sharp words. And I think that if we study the lifestyle of Gaurakishore Das Babaji Maharaj, he was extremely renunciated. I mean, so much so that it wasn't even humanly possible. I mean, who can eat like mud from the Ganges and roll it into a ball and eat it? And that would be his sustenance, his food. So I think that if we're going to speak about a sadhu, we need to know the lifestyle of that individual. And then those words will cut through the illusory energy that we're all captivated with. Like if you were with Srila Prabhupada, when we heard him speak, he had sharp words. He called everybody an ass, a camel, a dog, a cat. And because we had firm faith in Srila Prabhupada's activities and his desire, those words actually were like, you know, they were pleasing. Whereas if a person was very absorbed in materialistic ideas and in conditioned life, if they heard that, they would think that that was obnoxious. You know, what do you call anybody a dog for? Or why are you calling somebody a cat? But for a devotee, for a person who is really surrendered to the lotus feet of a sadhu, because they feel that this individual, there's a connection, and they can accept that particular language and the sharp words as being nectarine, because it's helping them become more and more detached from the material world. So I think that's an important aspect of it.
I'll try, after hearing my exalted godbrother speak, I'm reminded of that old translation of a line from one of the Vaishnava songs, Adhikari, let the right to preach be mine. So the way I was trained is that you speak according to your level of realization. So if I'm actually walking the walk and talking the talk, then I have the right to preach at what I am actually following. Otherwise, it's a hypocritical, and it won't have any effect on anybody. But if I'm actually following, whatever degree I'm following, if that's what I preach, it will have potency, and it will affect others. What else? More?
I actually just read something by your Guru Maharaj, Gaur Govinda Maharaj, and it said, you know, he was kind of speaking in sort of like this mood, like he was saying, like, you know, instead of going around preaching to everybody, you should first preach to yourself. So he was speaking about how, like, if you aren't, like you were saying, walking the walk, then whatever you preach is almost like, it's like kind of like an empty words. You know, there's no like Shakti behind it. So he's saying like, you know, if you want to preach, you should, I think he said like close the door on yourself, and you know, so he was saying like, first preach to yourself before you preach to others.
Yay. What else? Yes, Judah Karma is ready to chime in. This is real Ishtagosti.
When somebody gets some reputation for being spiritually advanced, people come to them asking for blessings, asirvad. So they want some material benefit. Yeah, please help me with this problem, please help me with that. So it said that to avoid such persons, Gaur Kishore Das Babaji would perform his bhajan at the public toilet where there were bad smells, so that such people wouldn't come and disturb him with their request for material blessings.
Good. Anything else? Yes.
I remember written in a book that Bhakti Vikas Maharaj was, the Bhakti Vai Baba book, where he says that at one point Gaura Kishora Das Babaji Maharaj gave an instruction to Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj, do not go to Calcutta. And immediately the thought comes, you know, like, yes, it's a very materialistic place. What is he going to do? And you get contaminated. But instead, Maharaj, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj, as we know, he went to preach. So I guess what I can understood from that is that the instruction was there, do not go. But if you can correct me, or someone can correct me, if you go and be influenced and just be part of the same mood as the city life. But actually he was a staunch preacher and he went there. And there's no contradiction in the instruction because he remained like a Vaikuntha man. Would that be correct, or you can add?
You, more than anyone, you know exactly the purport, because we learned from Prabhupada. You book distributors learned from the beginning. We're going out into the deepest depth bowels of Maya. We're not afraid. Why? Because we're going there to give our association and not take theirs. Exactly Prabhupada too. He came to give his association. So yes, everything is dependent upon what is the intention. So yes, we can go Venice Beach, colleges, downtown, all over the world. We're not afraid to go anywhere in the world. Jhuta Karma goes into the depths of the Darwinian hell. But he's not, and he has to deal with the greatest, the most intelligent demons on the planet, the super nerd demons. And he has to smash them with the club of his beautiful preaching. So yes, we can go anywhere. We're fearless because we're going to give. We're going anywhere to give Prabhupada, to give Lord Chaitanya, to give Krishna. And Prabhupada writes, we will be protected, provided that is our intention. But as soon as the intention is, I've come to enjoy, then you are snared by Maya. Is that okay? What else? Are we fired up? All right, let's go fight Maya. Hare Krishna. Yeah.